Can you tell me your name, please, and where you were born?
Yes. Well, I was born in Brno, Czechoslovakia, which is the capital of Moravia. And my name is, or was, Hugo Meisel, M-E-I-S-L. And today it's Marom, which is M-A-R-O-M. And the reason for the change of the name was that I was serving in the Air Force and was sent abroad. And at that time, Ben Gurion in the 50s thought that, had actually instructed not to change my name, because Meisel is one of the oldest Jewish names in Czechoslovakia, and my ancestors go back more than 1,000 years in Prague. But due to instructions which are given to offices, and some lady read my received my passport one day prior to my going abroad to bring a new aircraft to Israel, she decided that Meisel was German, and changed my name to Marom without asking. So, and then I stayed with this name for 7 years, and ever since. By the way, Meisel is a chisel in German, and it is an anagram of the word Ismel in Hebrew, which is a chisel. So in a good German dictionary, you will find Meisel, O-R-G means origin, H-B-R, Hebrew, Ismel, I-S-M-E-L, anagram, okay. So that's the way it's, so it's basically, and they were jewelers. The original Meisels were jewelers. They were brought from the lowlands by the king to Prague.
Not coffee makers.
No, that's Meinl. That's Meinl with an N. Very good, very good. And, but they originated in the Habsburg Empire in Vienna, if I'm not mistaken, the Meinls. Anyhow, getting back to the Meisels, it's spelled in many different ways, and you'll find that that one of my ancestors set up the synagogue in Meisel Street in Prague, which is called, it's one of the oldest synagogues in Prague, in the Jewish quarter, and it's called the Meisel Synagogue. And sometime in the 17th century, according to the cemetery stones, the family moved to Brno for whatever reason. So my great grandparents are buried in Brno already, my father's side, and my mother's side. They also come from Bohemia, from a small town in the southern part of Bohemia, which is called in German Schittenhofen, which in Czech is Sušice. And it's very famous for it's in the wooded area of Bohemia, and it's famous for it's in the area of České Budějovice, which is famous for Hartmut pencils and matches and that sort of products which are made of wood. A long answer to a short question.
That's a good answer. Tell me a little bit about your memories in Brno before the war.
And Brno is, first of all, we come from, my father served in the what they call the Czech Legion, that part of the there were four brothers, and two of them served in the Austrian army under Kaiser Franz Josef, and my father went to the academy. He was the third. His name was Pavel Meisel, and he went to the academy, the officers' academy, was sent to the front line, and was captured by the Russians. And most of the units which were captured by the Russians became turncoats, if you like, if you want to call it that, and fought with the Russians in the Czech Legion against the Austrians. In fact, on the same front as his brother, who was also in the artillery and who was injured during the war, and died in 1936, spent 18 years in hospital in Brno. So Brno is, being the second largest town, was divided in the Jewish community between German-speaking and Czech-speaking Jews. And I think they were most probably split something around 60-40, 60 Czech-speaking and 40%. Maybe it was 65 or something of that kind. I can't tell you. I mean, those are records which most probably could be checked properly. But my father belonged, my family belonged to the Czech-speaking Jewish group, A, because of his background. Secondly, he continued serving in the reserves as an officer. In fact, he was called up in 1938 during the Munich debacle, you know, when the French and the English under Chamberlain handed over the Sudetenland to the Germans. So basically that finished the defense lines that Czechoslovakia had, which were practically impregnable. There are theories that had they not taken the Sudetenland, the Germans would not have been able to enter Czechoslovakia. But getting back to my memories, my mother was a skiing teacher in winter. She was an Olympic swimmer in her youth, which was very unusual in those days. She was born in Vienna to my grandfather, my mother's side, who was a banker and was sent by the bank from Czechoslovakia to Vienna to serve at a branch, which he then finally managed. They had no children when they came to Vienna, so all the five children, my aunts and uncles, were born in Vienna. So my mother was born in Vienna to a Czech family, spoke Czech and German. And
what was her name?
Her name was Erna in German, Erna Kubie, K-U-B-I-E. And in Czech, Arnoštka Kubie, Kubiova, because it's all the Czech names have the ova at the end. And in summer she was a tennis coach, which was also unusual at that time. So she spent half the year, perhaps a little more than half the year, coaching tennis right down below our house. We had a very large park, a public park, which had four tennis courts, which were turned into ice skating rings in the winter. We were three brothers. My oldest brother, who passed away from due to a chicken bone getting stuck in his throat, and by the time they got him to hospital, he passed away. So we were two of us, my youngest brother Rudy Meisel, who hasn't changed his name, lives in California, northern part of Los Angeles, and he's also spent his life in aviation, basically. Compared to my mother, I was not a sportsman, a natural sportsman, as my brother was, who not only went back to Czechoslovakia with me after the war in 1945, but in 1946, nearly all my uncles and aunts had left Vienna in 1938 to go to the United States, and they were in Chicago, and they wanted us to come. Our parents didn't come back from concentration camp. So they wanted us to go to the United States, And I was studying engineering at the time, and I had a good stipendium support, a scholarship, which was fully paid. And in addition to that, I had a very good job teaching English at the secondary school, which I attended before the war. So my brother went, and getting back to this sportsman thing of it, he became a ping pong champion of Chicago and joined the Air Force, spent the whole war in Korea, flying on B-29s as a radar gunner and operator, and coming back, he got the GI plan and did electronic engineering and spent the rest of his life in both in Douglas flight test and then at Lytton on inertial navigation systems and so on. Now, he is a natural sportsman. He was behind in the 50s, behind establishing female soccer in the United States, and played soccer till till he was 80 something years old, and he's unfortunately suffering from Parkinson at the present moment, so it's very, very depressing for him, you know, for somebody who's so active, to have an active mind and not being able to control his body movements. So, getting back to Brno, to your question, I was at my mother's skirt side most of the time, for two reasons. Number one, she always took me on the skiing trips when she took a group of 30 or 40 people into the Alps. They used to go skiing to the Austrian Alps, which is about 2 hours away by car from Brno, to the point that I spent a lot of time in the kitchen watching her cooking, and it became a sort of a second hobby of mine, trying to copy all my life my mother's cooking. So these memories are very, very clear to me, to the extent that I remember what she put into the various things she cooked, and she was a very good cook. Apart from that, I was relatively a good student. I took French classes in addition to my elementary school. And my father and mother were at loggerheads, in the question of Hitler and Mein Kampf. My mother, who read Mein Kampf, both my father did, believed every word that Hitler said he would do. My father, who was by 1968, when President Dubček, who during the spring of Prague, if you remember, when the Russians came back in, he had given permission for a book to be printed. It's called A Thousand Years of Jews in Bohemia. And I received a copy in 1968 when it was published here in Israel. A friend of mine, who's a professor at the university, sent it to me. And it was addressed to the last of the Meislikans, instead of Mohicans. He wrote Meislikans. So in this this atmosphere, I was brought up in a very nationalistic way. We went to a Czech school, which was on the square, which was called the Square of the 28th of October 1918, which was the Independence Day of Czechoslovakia from the Habsburgs after many, many years of being, I don't know what you would call it, a part of the empire. And
do you remember
Masaryk? I never saw him. I never saw him, but I remember very clearly the time when he passed away. There were They built a sort of a monument at school, and I do remember certainly something very interesting, the morning prayers in the elementary school. Now, in our, I was, there were two Jewish boys in the, in my class of about 30 students. I can't remember exactly the number. I remember the teacher's name. His name was Sanka. He was the prime teacher. And when he walked into the class, the whole class got up, all boys. The girls were on the floor up above, where my cousin Renee was still alive, but she was the only one that survived the concentration camps. He walked in, the class would get up, and I can't remember exactly the words of the prayer, but the prayer was intended to be able to be read to all four religions which were in this classroom. We had Catholics, Protestants, Greek Orthodox, and Jews, okay, more or less. With two Jewish boys, a boy called Ziskind, who went to Palestine, he's not long alive, in 1939. The prayer would go something like this. We pray to our only God, the main points I would pick up. It was quite a standard prayer, and everybody would say it aloud. May God take care of our parents. May He take care of Tatichek Masaryk. Tatichek is a diminutive of father, Tata Tatichek Masaryk. And may He protect us, this God, from the Hungarians and the Austrians and the Germans. Every morning, this same prayer. So it's a very nationalistic atmosphere which I grew up in. Very, very keen on watching sports, starting with soccer, of course, ice hockey. The Czech ice hockey team was always very, very good in Europe and so forth. In fact,
were you a soccer player?
I was a soccer player. In fact, I have a picture at home somewhere. I played for the Czech national team in England during the war of the under-21s. And we lost again. My last game was against the English team, and we lost 7-1, and I gave 2 goals. How do you work that one out, Professor Sidowski? Well, I was a left back, and in those days in soccer, the goal kick was taken by the backs and not by the goalie as today. So it was a very windy day. It was something like 40 knot wind blowing against us. And when I kicked twice, I kicked the ball off the goal kick, and the ball went up and came down behind the goalie, who was standing sort of in front of the, very leisurely in front of the, goal, and went into the net. Twice this happened. So we lost 7-1, and I scored 2 goals. I was also taught tennis by my mother, but as I said to you, I was quite a good soccer player, but not tennis. I still play tennis to this day, but I play more with my mind, and I ski with my mind rather than by natural ability, whereas my brother is exactly the opposite. My brother has a trauma. He does not, he was 8 years old when he left. I was nearly 11. We left in July, and I was born on the 9th of October, so I was nearly 11. My brother was 8 and a half, and he has a trauma that he does not remember his parents. I mean, he knows when he sees the picture, because this is my father, this is my mother, but he has no memories of anything except playing soccer with a tennis ball in the park, which I spoke to you about, that had the tennis courts. It was a very big park, the largest park in Brno. It was right under our house. And he, when we went back after, in 1990, after the turnover, the communists left, he couldn't remember the house or anything of that kind, but when we went into this park, he remembered exactly where one of the benches was, and he remembered a stand where they used to sell cold, iced, sour milk, which we used to get. It's like a stand selling sodas and so forth. So one of the most popular drinks in those days was ice cold sour milk, okay? Sour cream, if you like. It was more sour, more milk than cream, but there was usually something on top. And it was sold out of large barrels. Apart from that, we used to get pocket money for milk, okay? On the way to school, we were to buy milk, something like most probably a third of a liter of milk. And I used to stop off at the grocery store, and with the same money, I used to buy sauerkraut out of a barrel, which I preferred to milk, which I always thought was something like cod liver oil or something like that that was forced onto us, or spinach or whatever.
Was your family at all religious?
My family, first of all, going back historically, they were all, always there was somebody, some rabbinical connections in the family. The youngest of my father's brother, René's father, Walter Meisel, was one of the best cantors in Brno. In fact, he played the piano, and for a long time he survived in Terezin because he was in the orchestra which played for the International Red Cross when they came. Okay, and he had a very good voice, and he sang in the main synagogue, which we did not attend. We attended a normal Orthodox synagogue. My father taught me long before we had a Hebrew teacher at school. My father taught me to read Hebrew, not to translate, but to read Hebrew like everybody else. And every Friday night we lit candles, and we sang Lechot Daudi and all the normal things. And on high holidays we would spend the whole day and so forth in synagogue. Apart from that, my mother believed that the best cure for any illness was shinke. So she did not keep a kosher home. And but that was a standard which was more or less a standard of the Czech Jews, as opposed to Slovak Jews and the Jews that came from Carpata Ruthenia, which where my wife comes from, okay, which was much more Orthodox, and there were more adherent Jews there than.
And where was she from?
My mother, my wife is from a place called in Czech Sebluš or Velký Sebluš, which is south of Užhorod, which is the capital of Carpata Ruthenia. They went to concentration camp in 1944, and she survived something like five or six camps, went to Auschwitz straight, was very fortunate, was only 4 days in Auschwitz and was taken to other camps. She participated in a death march, survived with her sister and her mother, who was very, very young, and came back to find that her father had not come back, and nor her brother didn't come back. Many other relatives didn't come back, but the three of them survived. And when they came back, they discovered that the Russians, that the agreement at Yalta between Roosevelt, Churchill and Stalin was that if the Russians got to Prague before the Americans, the Czechs would allow this part of Czechoslovakia to become part of the Soviet Union, which they did. They closed the borders, and they didn't allow. They made a census of who wanted to go to Czechoslovakia. And when they found that the percentage of people who didn't want to stay I'm speaking about 1945, when they found out that the majority wanted to be part of Czechoslovakia, they closed the borders and didn't allow anybody to leave. Now, obviously, the Jews were among those, as opposed to Ukrainians, who wanted to leave. So they were organized escapes across the border through Romania, Hungary, back to Slovakia or wherever, to Czechoslovakia. And my sister, my wife, her sister and her husband, she was married, and the mother, with a group of people, decided on Rosh Hashanah of 1946, that's a year and a half after the war, to escape to Czechoslovakia. And on the border, I'm sorry about this. I'm just sorry about that. Hello? Ken? Okay, yeah. Bye, Dan. There's Israel's playing in the Davis Cup against Sweden today. So it's my daughter. Where was I?
They escaped the Czechoslovakia.
Yes, they on the way in no man's land at 4 or 5 in the morning, it was still dark. They heard the word Stuy and the Russian army opened fire, killed, well, nobody knew what had happened. My wife and sister were close to each other. They ran, everybody ran in some direction. My wife remembers her brother-in-law throwing off his heavy coat and also running. And more than a year or 2 years later, when they got through Romania, it's a long story, my wife, if she wants to, she will tell you about it. They got to Czechoslovakia, and then they discovered that the Russians had shot her mother and the and her brother-in-law, and actually hung them up in Sevluš with a notice, this will happen to anybody who tries to get away. She doesn't know where. We haven't been back since, although I wanted to go back. They had a hotel and a restaurant there, and something is preventing her from wanting to go back. Don't know. I beg your pardon?
What did your father do?
My father and his brother inherited a chain of stores, which were kind of boutiques. They were divided into two kinds. One was the largest toy store in Brno, with electric trains and all that sort of thing, plus a small section of children's and baby clothing. And my father ran in another part of town, the store, which was a boutique for mainly for men, special men's wear, sort of exclusive type of store, not a very large store. And he spent a lot of time on the reserve duty whenever he could. And at that time, my mother would replace him in the store. And she was always annoyed about it when she had to do it, because she had to give up her tennis lessons. My father was my mother was a strong character in the family. She also, I started telling you about the two differences, that my father believed that because they'd been in Czechoslovakia for 1,000 years, he says, if the Germans do anything to the Czech Jews, they'll have to get rid of 12 million Czechs as well, because we're a part of this. My mother said, don't be ridiculous. He's going to pick us out, as he says, and he's going to get rid of us. Nobody spoke of murder, of that type of thing, of getting rid of the people, of getting rid of Jews out of Europe, cleaning Europe of Judaism. There was no indication at that time that there would be anything like the Holocaust, okay? So just like in Germany, people believed there were more German than there were Jews. We were in the census of 1930, under Masaryk, which was most probably the most democratic and the most advanced nation in the world as far as freedoms were concerned. I know the French spoke about liberté, fraternité and all this, but the real democracy was Czechoslovakia. In the center of Europe, under Masaryk, He allowed, in my town, universities were German and Czech. In Prague, the same thing. Slovenians, Bulgarians, Ukrainians, they all could teach and go to school and practice whatever minority they belonged to, including Germans. And so forth. Maybe they were not popular if they were speaking German in towns of Brno and Prague and other towns in Czechoslovakia, which were even more Czech, because Bohemia, Moravia, other than Brno and Prague, the towns were very much, if there were Jews there, they were the Jews who were Czech majority rather than German, except for the Sudetenland, where they had no choice because in those areas German was the accepted language. So finally, when my father realized that my mother was right, it was too late. There was no way that they could get out. So that's the reason why they opted for trying to send us abroad. And the first attempt, as you will hear from Aaron Tomaszow, his father, Willy Tomaszow, Aaron Tomaszow, Willy originally, he was one of three brothers. His father was very active in the Zionist movement. His whole Tomaszow family, as he will tell you all about it, were very active in Brno and in Bratislava and so forth. His mother also came from Vienna. She was a very good friend of mine. They went to school together. He had a friend in London by the name of Rabbi Rabinovich, who eventually became quite a high-standing rabbi in England, who he wrote to and asked to take his, there were three brothers, to arrange for them to go to England. And he did this. He had made these arrangements. And then he gave my father the address, and my father wrote to this Rabbi Rabinovich. And he wrote back that he had arranged for us to be accepted into an Orthodox hostel orphanage in London. But just for an interesting record, this Rabbi Rabinovich writes back to my father saying, "I do request you not to give my name more or less to anybody else, to any Jews in Brno, because I don't want all the Jews in Brno turning on to me to find them accommodation for this children." I haven't published this thing because it lines up with another problem which occurred with Nicholas Winton, that most of the places that he found were not Jewish families, although there were Jewish families in England who could have easily and very easily taken Jewish children in. Again, it's very difficult for me to tell you what I remember from pre-war Czechoslovakia for another very interesting reason. We came back. We went to the Czechs in 1943. The interesting part was that my father wasn't too pleased with this idea of sending us to an orphanage in London. So he approached Bill Barazzetti, and he arranged. Actually, we left having two places to go to, basically. And I can't tell you, in the diary which my father prepared for me to go, he writes that we shall go to this orphanage, which not until recently I found the address. But we arrived at the station together with the Tomaszow boys, and we were the only five out of 200-odd children who were not picked up. And we were left standing at the Liverpool Street station between 6:30, 7 o'clock in the morning when the train arrived from Harwich. And by 10:30 in the evening, nobody had picked us up, and we were sitting on our suitcases when a cab driver came and asked us, and I was the only one who spoke a few words of English because I'd been learning English for over a year, asked us what we were waiting for. He said, we're waiting for somebody to pick us up. And he asked us whether we were hungry. And I said, we're very hungry, because the last time we ate was a sandwich in Hook of Holland before we got on the boat. And we didn't all eat it because it was very soft white bread, which we didn't, which we hadn't been used to. So he took us to a fish and chip shop in his cab, five of us, with the suitcases. And I must tell you, it's the finest meal I ever had in my life. And it was the first time I had fish prepared the way that the British prepare fish. And it was the first time I'd seen chips. It was not, can you imagine Czechoslovakia not being acquainted with this, with pommes frites, with the chips. So that wasn't the end of the story. The next thing is that, of course, he had nowhere to go. So he takes us to a high-rise council building where he lived. Young man, had a baby, a one-room apartment. He put us on the floor, put all sorts of things on the floor, and the five of us slept in this small apartment. The next day, I remember before we were going out, I went down into the street, and I stood on the pavement watching double-decker buses, which I hadn't seen before. And I vividly remember one stopping right next to me and indicating to me that I should cross the road, because he thought I was going to cross the road. So this was something also very, very memorable. And he spent the next 3 days with us in the cab looking for a place who would accept us. Now, he didn't, I would say on the average that at the beginning he was looking for places which perhaps we were supposed to go to. My theory is that that this hostel, which I now know, which no longer exists, was very orthodox. It's mentioned in the letters as well. And somebody did arrive from this hostel. And he saw five boys without kepler, without tzitziot. And this was a place which was very, very orthodox. He turned around and left us there. So that's one thing. The other thing is, what Bill Barazet in Winton arranged was a home for us, apparently with a childless couple, where the father wanted to surprise his wife with two children. And he apparently died of a heart attack during the time when before we left and before we arrived. So his wife didn't know anything about it, not to this very day. And so we were dependent on this hostel coming to pick us up. This is one of the reasons that Nicholas Winton, in his diary and so forth, writes that he appointed Bill Barazetti to make sure that parents didn't approach more than one body. But this approach was made already at that critical time when apparently certain parents approached the Brabazons, the Salvation Army, anybody. They were hysterical about trying to get the children out. You know how something, news like this spreads, that what's going to happen and so forth. And finally, one thing I do remember is arriving at a hostel. It was a Saturday morning. We arrived on Thursday, Friday. You can check when we arrived by, all these computers. You can get the dates back, what day it was on that particular day. And on Saturday morning, we stopped in front of a hostel, and he took me to the door of this hostel, and a lady opened the door, and he asked her that he'd phoned or something like that. He'd already been contacted, that he'd brought these boys. And she asked me, not at that time I didn't realize anything until we left the door, if I had any keys in my pocket or any money. So I said, yes, I have a few shillings and keys, the suitcase keys. And I showed them to her. And of course she said, we can't, we are full up, we can't accept children, because it was a Saturday morning and And here I was carrying keys and money in my pocket. So those are the type of things that I remember. Of course, after the war, I looked for this taxi driver, and there was no way through the taxis and police and so forth, but didn't succeed in finding him. Most probably, he was killed during the war in either in bombing or in the army, because he was young enough to serve in the army. That's the assumption.
Let me take you back just for a second.
Yes.
You played soccer. You went to a Czech school.
Yes.
Your parents ran boutiques.
Yeah.
Did you have non-Jewish friends? Did you?
Yes. My father served in the army was connected through the army, through the services, with the father, whose name I don't remember, of Tonda Sekal. And he was in the banking business, a non-Jew. And he passed away, and my father took care of his widow. They were in the process of building a country home outside of town, a villa, which exists to this day. Very, very modern to this day building, very unusual style, square block, very modern. He finished paying the half of this house for the widow. And we used the half of the, one third of the home. The widow had three children, a polio attacked son by the name of Otto, and Tonda, who was a skiing teacher and a tennis coach, and was younger than my mother, but they worked together for the same club, both skiing and tennis. And as I was born without any grandfathers and only with one grandmother, both paternal grandparents were no longer alive, the Meisels were no longer alive. The only grandmother I had was my mother's mother in Vienna, who in 1938, when Hitler came to Vienna, because she was Czech, she came and her children had gone to the United States and she was living alone. She came to Brno to live with us immediately when Hitler came in. Czechoslovakia was considered a haven at that time for Jews and so forth. So, in a way, Tonda's mother, that is the widow of Mr. Sekal, my father's friend, became a grandmother, and we called her grandmother. And we used to spend a lot of time there at weekends, to the extent that when the Germans took my parents to Terezin, where they spent only 4 days before they went to Auschwitz, or to that area, they came and picked them up and allowed them to take, I don't know, 20 pounds, 20 kilos, I don't know how much exactly, I can't tell you, with them, leaving everything as it was. They weren't allowed to take any jewelry or anything like that. Leave the place as it was. They came at night. Tonda Sekal had the the initiative, because it was well known that they were coming up, that they were picking up Jews. He took a truck and cleared a 5-room apartment of furniture, clothing, jewelry, everything that was in it, and took it by truck to the villa outside of town. They built, together with his sister and his brother, a big hole in the ground the size of this room, and put everything in there, lined it with tar paper, built a concrete slab on top of it with a slit so that he could put documents and some things, that letters that came in afterwards. When we came back in 1945, we dug up everything that was there. Everything was in perfect condition. Money, paper money from the time, bills, receipts, jewelry, clothing, furniture. My father had bought from the palace as a wedding present to my mother, he bought a bedroom suite from Schönbrunn, from the Kaiser, from Kaiser Joseph's palace, which was very, very valuable. It was so valuable that when my brother Rudy went to America, it enabled me to fit him out for the trip, to buy him a sea ticket to go to the United States and give him enough money for the trip by selling this bedroom suite, which was a double bed, posted and so forth, with a makeup table and a small table where we used to learn Hebrew, special chairs and a very large armoire, a cupboard, and so forth. How did I get to this?
Well, I asked if you had non-Jewish friends.
Yes. So this family, this wasn't everything that he did. During the war, we had sent letters to our original address, which Germans moved in, where we lived, into the apartment. Letters we sent, which I still have copies of, which came through Hungary and through Yugoslavia and Sweden, friends that my father had from years in the army and so forth. Some of them were Czech friends, some of them were maybe business friends, or what is this part of it? Ah, okay. Yes, so when we answered, and I also have these letters, because when these letters arrived, Tonda Sekal would, on a number of occasions, take the train to Poland, go to the fence of this camp where my mother was a cook. She apparently, I don't know exact details, she was a cook in a adjacent prisoner of war, Russian prisoner of war camp. And she could go to the fence, and he found out where she was, and he would bring our letters to her. And she would write letters on very thin airmail paper. In fact, somebody checked out when we came back, some of this was rice paper, so that if they caught Tonda Sekal on the train, he could actually eat this paper. And he took this risk a number of times. In fact, after the war, when I came back and we met, I had planned to ask him if there had been a love affair between Tonda Sekal, who was at least 15 years younger than my mother, I think, 10 to 15 years younger. And I never got round to asking him before he passed away at the age of 85 or something like that. So I can't tell you, but the type of risks that he took are way beyond anything that you can imagine. In fact, when we came back from England in 1945, and we found people living, Jewish people, I don't know whether you know what happened after the war. The Germans, of course, left the apartments which they had taken from the Jews. They ran away immediately to Austria, to Germany, and so forth. They disappeared. They were not chased out. They left on their own when they saw what was happening. A, because of the Russians, and secondly, because of the Czechs. So I came back and I found two women living in my apartment, in our apartment, who'd come back from concentration camps. So I had no intention of, and there was no request on their part to say, come and live with us, you know, the two of us. So Tonda immediately said, you come and live in your apartment outside of town in this villa. So we came to live with them, and we were there until just after Rudy, my brother, left for the United States. And then I decided that out of the five rooms, these two women and their son were living in four rooms. So I said, I'm going to get one room back and I will live in Brno, because I wanted to study at the university engineering. And so I went back to the apartment. The answer to the total answer, these were my parents' best friends. There were many friends, Jewish friends, who they played bridge with, and who non-Jewish friends, which my mother had due to the skiing teaching and due to tennis, because tennis wasn't a Jewish game, okay? Nor was skiing really. It was really a sport for those who could afford it, okay? Going out of the country, and I'm speaking about organized trips, whereas skiing was so popular that anybody could, the lowest of the lowest could get a pair of skis and go for a day skiing in winter, okay? I would say that the majority of my parents' friends were Jewish, but the best friends were non-Jewish, okay?
And conversely, do you remember ever experiencing any anti-Semitism in school or in the streets?
I was brought up, and I think the whole school was brought up, in an atmosphere that Judaism is not a race. The Jewish, being Jewish is not a race, it's a religion. It has nothing to do with anybody. It's a thing between my family and the Hebrew teacher, the synagogue, just as they went to the Catholic Church. In 1935, I was 7 years old, my brother was five and a half, and we kept on talking about Kurt, my brother who had died, was the oldest, who died from this chicken bone. And we kept on putting food into the window for the stork to bring us another brother. And in those days, I think today they teach the children from class one how babies are born. We certainly were not taught, so we believed in the stork. And so one day my parents brought in a surprise, they brought a boy by the name of Peter. He had no name because he came from there were no Jewish children in the Jewish orphanage in Brno. There were only Catholic children and other children, but there were no Jewish children. So he brought this Catholic boy by the name of Peter, who became Peter Meisel. He's also on the list. He was to go out. And he was brought up in the following way. He participated in everything that we did as Jewish children. And every Sunday morning, we would accompany him very early in the morning to the church, the Catholic church. We weren't allowed in. We were waiting outside for an hour and so forth. We ran around, played and so forth, in a park which was very close, and then the three of us would come back home. When the Germans moved in, I can't tell you whether it was 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or a month after March 1939, the Gestapo one day arrived. I was not at home. My brother Rudy was at home. My parents were at home. It must have been a Sunday. I was either playing soccer or something. Apparently, according to stories handed over, because I wasn't there, so it's hearsay, a couple of Germans arrived, a man and a woman, dressed in leather coats practically to the ground, Gestapo. They told my mother there's no place for a non-Jewish child to be with a Jewish family, to pack all his things, all his toys, and everything that he had when he came and what he had received since he'd been with us for 3 years. Or 4 years nearly, and they took him away. And after the war, I looked for him. He's in the list. He was in the list to go to England. Peter Meisel, you'll find him there. The orphanage, although he was by that time 17 years old after the war, I didn't find him after the war. The name Meisel, obviously, children in orphanage don't have surnames. They only have their Christian names. So he either was killed during the war, or served in the army, or died, or passed away. Although during the bombing of this orphanage, which was completely destroyed by the Russians during the attack on Brno, they claimed there were no children. There was nobody there at the time, that they were in shelters, that nobody was killed there. But I never found him, and never found any records. Until the search went on for many years, until about 4 years ago, I always checked telephone books for the name Meisel, and of course there are a lot of Meisels, and I used to phone them up. And one day, I rang up a Meisel family near Brno, and they answered the phone, a lady answered the phone, and I said, would there be anybody, an older person, about the age of 70 to 80, by the name of Peter Meisel? So she said, my husband's father was Peter Meisel. I said, where was he born? And she said, we don't know. We believe he came from an orphanage. I've corresponded with this family, who is a very famous musical family. They're all musicians. In fact, one of the sons, he's no longer alive, so there's no way, and there are no documents, no way to prove anything. We've been corresponding every year for Christmas and so forth. The son was world champion in Russian organ, writing music and playing. These big organs, what are they called? Accordions, yes. They're Russian and small ones and so forth, so Russian. And I've got recordings at home of classical music on accordions and so forth. So we haven't met yet. We're planning to do it next time we go. Although there's absolutely no way. They've tried. Okay.
At what point do you think your parents decided it was time to send you?
As I said to you, there were a lot of discussions which I heard. They were certainly not minor sort of discussions. They were annoying discussions between two very opposing opinions. And I think that from the letters, I should most probably from the documents, I think it must have been it must have been very close, if not after the invasion of that finally that the penny dropped with my father, who was not even at home during the Munich Sudetenland transfer. He was in the army, both with Tonda Sekar in the same unit in Uzhhorod, down in Karpat-Ruthenia, where their unit was. So I think only when he came back.
And after the Munich conference?
It definitely was after. It was, and I would say it was closer to, most likely, after the Germans moved in March, because I don't think the correspondence dates back to any... I would have to look at that. It's a good question. I've never thought about it. But... I have the correspondence to London, and I think it's all April, May 1939, after the invasion. I can't imagine my father, from knowing how very nationalistic feeling he had about the Czechs and so forth. And he was a strong believer that that religion... I was brought up under the understanding that we were Czechs, many generations, that that allegiance was to a country, and religion was the business of the individual, and had nothing to do with and the whole arrangement of all the documents that a Czech had to have. Document of belonging to a country, which had no mention of whether you were Jewish, Protestant, Catholic, or whatever. A Domovsky list, which is a document saying where is your home, in which town, where do you belong to, and a birth certificate, which was the only document which mentioned of what religion you were born in, or a census which asked you for your state relationship, your home relationship, and your religion. And they had two, if you come one evening, I will show you the census document which speaks of race and religion as two separate things. Martha's parents register under religion Jewish, and under race Israeli. I'm sorry about this. How long do you think this was last? Because I had an appointment. Yeah, Ken, אנחנו, אני בדיוק שואל כמה זמן זה עוד ייקח. שנייה אחת. What do you say?
We could stop if you have any questions, and we could continue some other time.
Yes. מה את אומרת? כן, כן, אני בלי, לא, זה לא, אני רוצה איזה קטע לגמור. זה לא היה... בוא נניח 12 ורבע. לא, לא, אז תרדי ותעלי למעלה. Can. Bye. Do you understand Hebrew?
No.
I'm sorry to speak Hebrew. 12:15, somebody's going to pick me up.
Okay. Let me just ask you one
yes.
thing. Somehow your parents got in touch with Nicholas Winton or with Bill Berzin.
Yes.
And they told you they were sending you to England?
Yes.
How did you feel at that point?
I think that I've heard this said by quite a number of people. I think we were quite excited about it. Here I'm learning English for a whole year. England is well known for its soccer and for whatever. It's as a nation considered an ally of Czechoslovakia, in spite of Mr. Chamberlain, going to a place like London, the largest city in the world. We knew that at that time it had 8 million people living in it, if it wasn't an underestimate already. I think we considered it, and my parents made sure that we consider it as an adventure. In fact, I'm in the process right now of, as you know, there are monuments to the children in London, Liverpool Street Station. There are plaques all over the place. Sir Nicholas Winton, Bill Barazetti didn't get this recognition. Oh, there's a long story of my arranging for Bill Barazetti to get recognition at Yad Vashem, and I didn't succeed with Nicky Winton, who I really started this business with. We believe that the heroes of this whole Kindertransport are not the Barazettis and the Wintons and the Chadwicks and so forth. The heroes of this story are the parents. And the parents for two reasons. Number one, it's very difficult. If you remember, Nicholas Winton speaks of the Americans not accepting 20,000 Czech children because of a decision, because apparently the president, but apparently the true story is that in Congress, when the voting came up whether to allow this 20,000 additional immigrants to come in, children immigrants, that somebody got up, which really caused this, prevented this from happening by getting up and saying in Congress that it's against the Holy Bible to separate children from their parents. This is one of the stories that I've heard. The question.
At what point, and how did you react?
Oh yes, no, what did we feel about it? So, as many others have said, my parents wanted this to become, wanted us to consider two things. One, that this was a temporary solution. B, that they would join us if it was necessary. C, they made sure it was an adventure. And I'll tell you that much, that my mother did not, although I have tickets, actually I have tickets that my father bought for both of us, himself and my mother. And my mother's ticket was not used because my mother came to the station in Brno before we went to Prague. I'm speaking about the trip from Brno to Prague, which is 4 hours by train or something like that, that time, in order not to make us feel that this is some sort of a parting, permanent parting or something of that kind.
So there were no tears?
There were no tears that I saw. There were no tears. There were no tears. There were no tears that I remember. And I think that that it was a matter of brainwashing us. And as I mentioned, I'm in the process of trying to arrange a monument to be set up to the parents in Prague at the Wilson station or at the Masaryk station, at both. And I proposed it, and the Czech foreign minister has accepted the idea, and they've spoken to the railway, the national railway thing. And I'm supposed to be speaking to the ambassador Jantowski here to find out exactly how to push on. And I've suggested, because my daughter, Evie, is a sculptress. She teaches sculpture and has been art all her life, that one of the, that she, prepare a sculpture to be put up at the station. Now, I said there were two reasons why I think that they were the heroes. The second reason is they went through the Holocaust twice. The word Holocaust isn't the right word, in my opinion. Genocide. But Holocaust maybe describes better what I'm... went through this suffering twice. Once, they sent their children to London, and Mr. Goebbels, who was the Minister of Information for Hitler, as one can hear by recordings, from practically October 1939, when the first bombing raid started on London, every day comes on the radio in German, which is heard by everybody who spoke German, and tells the people that they're bombing London and killing so many thousand women and children to convince the British to stop fighting against the Germans. They've sent the children to London. They don't know where they are. They think that they know, but they're receiving letters, or not yet receiving even letters. They're already receiving information about London being bombed, whilst they are not carrying the Star of David yet. There is no food shortage yet. There is no prevention of Jews going to parks, and all this has not started yet. And they've sent their children to be bombed in London. In my opinion, can you just imagine, I assume that you have children, what sort of, what you went through? Must have gone crazy from all these news, not being able to call, no telephones, there's no contact whatsoever. A letter takes between 2 weeks to 3 weeks to go from one end to the other. So this is the first time. And the second time is when they went personally through whatever they went through during the period of the occupation till 1942, when they went to Terezin. And the time that whatever, and I don't know to this day exactly how and where and so forth, only court assumptions where both parents and my grandmother was taken away at the same time because the apartment was cleared. Whoever lived at that apartment went to this transport to Terezin.
Okay, I would like to continue this sometime before we leave.
Okay.
Tell me when, and when.
What a small world, huh? What a small world. And I just now spoke to Moshe Tadmor, who is the manager of Zdedov Airport. He came back this morning from Guatemala and Cuba. They were there a month.
You know, there what?
1 month. Most probably in the same hotels and so on.
The last time we spoke, you had talked about a taxi driver who took you to his
home.
What happened after that?
I don't know whether I went into the details. The five of us slept in his apartment for 3 nights, I believe, 2 or 3 nights. You know, some of us who've participated in the same moments in life, and many years later we sit down and we discuss those moments, we get two different stories. So Willie Tomashov, Aaron Tomashov, the judge, who you were supposed to interview day before yesterday or yesterday, he was with us. He's one of the, there were three Tomashov boys, two of them, one of them died fighting in Jerusalem in the War of Independence, and the other one was became a very prominent lawyer in Chicago, and he died in Chicago. So Willie, who was the middle one, still alive, and as I said, he would most probably, if you were to ask him the same question, would tell us that perhaps we only spent 1 night or 3 nights or 4 nights. Anyhow, I remember 3 nights. And finally, we somehow, apparently after that, I don't know whether I mentioned the fact that we went to this East End orphanage, and they wouldn't accept us. Most probably was the one we were supposed to go to. And I think he became wise at that instant, what actually was the problem of the Jewish orphanages or hostels or whatever would accept us in the East End because there were two Orthodox. So he took us to a hostel in North London in Cricklewood at 71 Shoot Up Hill, which is part of Edgware Road running out of London, one of the longest roads, into a hostel which comprised of the Kinder from Germany.
Who had come on the
Kindertransport from Germany and were billeted at number 71 Shoot Up Hill, and also one more hostel nearby where we used to go for lunches and so forth. Now, I don't know whether we discussed before that we belonged to this Czech group of Jews, to the Jewish community, which considered itself being Czech above all, and the religion was secondary, and we've always prayed at school and so forth to protect us from the Germans, Hungarians, and so forth. The five of us are put into a hostel where there are something like 70 German boys. And from the first moment, it was like putting the Czech army against the German army, because, if, as I said before, we did not consider religion important. We considered nationality important.
Were these Jewish boys?
All Jewish boys. Yet they were Germans.
Of course.
So here was a condition which resulted in daily fist fights. And I have letters from my parents which I wrote that such and such a boy beat up my brother, so I beat him up and so forth. And my parents' letters to us at that time later on speaks of this condition and tells us, you're all Jewish boys, what the hell is going on? You know, that sort of thing. So that's where he brought us, and we never saw this man again. Okay, we're talking about the taxi driver. And I can't tell you how long we were there, but immediately we were sent to the Haben School, H-A-R-B-E-N school, in Swiss Cottage, which was like 20 minutes, half an hour walking distance away. There were no buses going in that direction. And we all enrolled in this elementary school, which, to cut a long story short, was bombed during one night. During one of the bombing raids in, if I'm not mistaken, in October, 1 month after the start of the war, during one of these night raids, a bomb fell into the playground. We were issued either before or at that time with gas masks. And within a couple of days, we were asked to pack everything that we had in suitcases, and we would be evacuated out of London, not being told where to. We were given a label again, each one of the English boys, and there was, although we were refugees, we were treated exactly as the other English children.
What was on the label?
And the number.
Just a number,
name and number. Similar to the label which we carried. You must have seen in the diaries of Nicholas Winton some of the typical labels which had no name but a number. And apparently the Germans were always busy with numbers. Yes. So here we were. We got on a train and got off an hour later, perhaps, the entire group, full train of children, and we got off at Bedford railway station. And at Bedford railway station, if I remember correctly, we must have been there a few hours. People from Bedford came and chose children, which they, English children, the evacuees, so-called evacuees. So we basically became, overnight, dropped refugees and became evacuees, because that's how we were treated in Bedford as evacuees. Only people who were very close to us realized that we were just a complex type of evacuee, that we're basically refugees from a country that they, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, Slovenia, all these years were to the English people, and a relatively intelligent town, retirement home of high-ranking officers in the British Army and Air Force. So that's how we landed up in Bedford.
And who took you?
We were my brother and I. I insisted that we would not be separated, and a family by the name of Chancellor, Chancellor, I think, who lived at number 13 Bower Street in Bedford, which is a street in the, I would say, the poorer section of Bedford, very close to the River Ouse and the park. Ouse, O-U-S-E, River Ouse, the famous river in that which flows out into the Wash on the east coast, on the east coast of England. And the Chancellors had three children, Sheila, Norma, and I've forgotten the boy's name, I only remember that particular afternoon when tea was served, and I think it was the first time that I had tea with milk where the tea was darker than coffee or whatever else. And having learned, having studied English for a whole year, I was the only one that could talk to these people, to the Chancellors. And it was very, it was a very difficult situation because Rudy, my brother, couldn't speak. We communicated in Czech between us, and I translated whenever she, whenever the landlady asked us to do. I remember this first tea and supper at the same time, more or less. And then Mrs. Chancellor said to me, "Well, you boys, go upstairs." And I'd never heard the word upstairs before. So I didn't respond to it. Thought perhaps we should go out or whatever. And finally I realized that upstairs meant going up, up the stairs. And they put us up, if I remember correctly, all five children with this two girls, three boys, in one room, in the girls' room or the boys' room. They all, there was only two bedrooms upstairs, relatively large bedrooms because they were over the sitting room, the kitchen, and the scullery, so the area down below. The toilet was at the end of the garden in a separate, like all the homes. And all the houses to this very day are identical except for the painting on the doors and the windows as they were in 1939. Why I say that is because only at Christmas, just before Christmas, we visited for the first time. I took Martha to Bedford. And we went, we decided we'd look for the Chancellors. So we knocked on the door at number 4 or 6. I wasn't sure of the number at the time. And in the third house, a lady opened the door. She was young, about 50, and she said, "Of course, I've been only here 5 years, so I wouldn't know the name at all." And at that point, the door-to-door thing, the buildings were, maybe the buildings are wide, 4 or 5 yards wide, that's the width. And there's a door and a window, that's all. So door-to-door, then window, window, door-to-door. A lady opens the door and she says, "Is there perhaps something I can do for you?" So I said, well, she seemed older, so I said, "We're looking for the Chancellors." So she says, "Well, you're very lucky. Unfortunately, except for Sheila," which then sort of I remember the name, "no one is alive anymore. And Sheila, who lives at number 13, I am looking after her cats. She's away for the weekend." So I left my card, and Sheila Chancellor rang me up a week later after we arrived here, and we decided we would exchange letters. What happened? The first thing she asked me on the telephone, "How is Rudy? Where is he? The last time he wrote to me from the war in Korea where he was flying." In the meantime, I wrote her a letter about what happened to our family, and also she wrote to me quite a nice long letter. So we were there for not very long, because five children in one room was very difficult on the Chancellors, and rather than send Rudy away, I saw that Rudy got on very well with both girls and the boy there, so there would be two boys and two girls in this room. One on top of another, I think, you know, they had these double beds, two-story beds. And I left for another home, and I don't remember at the moment What I can tell you is the next morning after when we got up, they took us to Goldington Road School, which was an elementary school practically at the end of the street, going the other direction. The street is about, I would say, a half a mile long, and each house is identical on both sides. It this crosses is, Castle Road.
This is still Bedford.
This is Bedford, yes. And we went to this elementary school for quite some time. I moved to some other billet. These were called billets. We were billeted with the chancellors. I later was billeted with another family. Finally, at one time there was nobody willing to accept children who were moving, and I was put into a home for evacuees who had not been placed anywhere. It was a home ran at number 1 Cardington Road, which is a very long road in Bedford. At number 1 Cardington Road, one of these homes was run by Mr. and Mrs. White, who were teachers, both were teachers from London. And they ran this hostel. I nearly called it a bostel, because most of the kids who were there were kids who either didn't get on with the landladies or in their billets, or something happened at the billet and they had to leave and there wasn't anybody else to take them at the moment. There must have been something like maybe 20, 30, maybe 40 children in this home. Mr. White was quiet. It was quite a very unkind type of a person. He used to beat us frequently for every discipline was with a cane, with a bamboo cane, and Mrs. White always tried to prevent him from beating the caning the children rather than beating, caning them. Beating has a sense of using your hands in beating somebody. We're talking about caning. And this is at the other end of on the other side of the river, so it was too far away from Goldington Road School. So I went to a new school, which was called the Silver Jubilee School. The Silver Jubilee School, the Silver Jubilee, means that it must have been Silver Jubilee is 25 years, if I'm not mistaken. So it must have been after Queen Victoria, it must have been during King George V's time, 25 years of his reign or something was set up. I can tell you that during this visit before Christmas, this school doesn't exist anymore, although it was a very modern school, beautifully built, beautiful playgrounds. It's been replaced by town development, and only a memorial is where the school stood, and the street next to it, named after a very interesting headmaster who I remember to this day by the name of J.J. Voice, V-O-Y-C-E, who was a very, I remember, very fair type of person, as far as caning was concerned and punishing people.
You said you were taken at one point to Swiss Cottage.
Swiss Cottage is part of North London.
Weren't there a lot of German Jews living there?
In Swiss Cottage? What I mentioned was that, this is just an interesting point, Swiss Cottage, I can tell you something about that particular area. First of all, the only thing that I knew at that point, at the beginning, was that the Haben School was off the main road. It's actually between St. John's Wood and Swiss Cottage, where the school was located. It no longer exists there because it was actually bombed out during the war and pulled down for modern buildings, most probably. But I can tell you this, I had an address of my mother's first cousin. Her name was Else Spielmann. And I had this address, and the address was written in such a way that it only had the name of where was Haver Court?
Belsize Park.
The only thing I had, Belsize Park, London, Spielmann. So I went on, I took Rudy, my brother, one Sunday whilst we were at this hostel, and we went to look for Mrs. Spielmann, who was a cousin that I never remembered who she was. I was 10 and a half years old or something like that. And we walked all the way from Cricklewood to Belsize Park, which is another distance from Swiss Cottage to the in the same direction. And we find that there is a Belsize Grove, a Belsize Mews, and Belsize Avenue, and Belsize Street, and Belsize whatever. And we went from place to place, and we're going down one of these Belsize roads, and all of a sudden I hear a woman screaming in German at a kid that's obviously a baby that's crying. And having heard this German, I said, this would be an interesting person to ask. Perhaps she knows where Else Spielmann, who came from Vienna and from Czechoslovakia, where she lives. So we walked up the stairs to this building, which had a number of apartments in. It was an old sort of upstairs and downstairs type of home where once upon a time rich English people lived. And in one room there, we walked in, and I asked if she knew if she had ever heard of Else Spielmann. She says, I'm Else Spielmann. And this little boy, Tony, was 2 years old. Today is quite a famous textile engineer living in Geneva. He's Swiss by now. His mother is not alive anymore. And we're in good contact together. So that's how one of the incidences that I remember very clearly. Another one was that from Cricklewood, 71 Shoot Uphill, we walked to the largest cinema in the world, which was called the Gaumont, G-A-U-M-O-N-T, which is on Edgware Road, was at that time called the largest cinema in the world. There was a pianist in front of an enormous stage. There must have been, I don't know, 1,500, 2,000 maybe places. Really, it was a very large cinema. And we went to see a film. It's continuous in England at the time. You walked in at any time during the film, and when it got to the same part, again, you walked out.
What was the movie?
I don't remember, but two things I remember. The organ playing between films, there were always two films, and at the end of the second film, they played the anthem. And it was the first time I heard God Save the King, and everybody got up. They've given up this. They used to play it in the theatres in London and all shows. They used to, during the war definitely, and even many years after the war. But now they've given up this practice. So those are my memories.
How did you feel standing? You must have stood up.
Yes, of course.
So how did you feel?
I think that that it reminds me of something which happened 2 years ago. We were invited as having volunteered to come and fight in the War of Independence, both Marta and myself. She was in the Army and I was in the Air Force. We were awarded the second highest Medal of Courage by the state of by the Czech Republic, personally by the Minister of Defense, and at a very big reception, the two of us, as representatives that they could find of those that volunteered to come to Israel during the War of Independence. And of course, they first played the Czech anthem, which is very unique in a way, followed by the Israeli anthem. And behind us were standing between 7 to 10 generals of the Czech army who had invited and other personnel. And whilst they were playing the Israeli anthem, you could hear everybody humming behind, because it's Smetana's music. But that's
like Hatikva.
So everybody, yes, that's where Hatikva was taken from. And now the words, you asked me how I felt then, the words of the Czech anthem, the first words, are Gde domov můj, where is my home? So I felt, in a very peculiar manner, being awarded a medal by the Czechs, being an Israeli in Prague 2 years ago, and I think I felt the same way at that time in London, that it was very peculiar that I should be there and listening to God Save the King.
Did you feel that was your home?
No, I never felt it was my home for two reasons. Number one, it's just impossible to imagine that we would not rejoin our parents. Whether at the beginning we were expecting them to come very quickly, they talked about 2 or 3 months. Later on it became obvious that they couldn't come as long as there was a war on. In fact, both of us refused to be adopted. We were twice, people wanted to adopt us twice during that period. Once an English family who was when I was a cadet, he wanted to adopt us. He was an English wing commander, and he had no children, so he wanted to adopt us. And then part of the family of the only Jewish, non-English master, he was an art master, a very famous Austrian architect whose pictures I have all over the place here, who was the art master at the Silver Jubilee School. And the first day he walked into the class and started asking names, he finally came to me, and I said, Hugo Meisel. And he said to me, you're not English, are you? Where are you from? So I said, I'm from Czechoslovakia, from Brno, Czechoslovakia. And I was insolent enough to say, and you are not English either, because I could hear this strong German accent. Where are you from? So he said, from Vienna. And following the lesson, we had a discussion. He tried to find out. I was the only Jewish boy in the school. And we became friends, and his brother-in-law, later on, at the end of the war, before we went back to Czechoslovakia, suggested that they wanted to adopt us. And of course, even at that time, we were still hoping, although my parents were not on the list of the International Red Cross lists were coming in from concentration camps and so forth. They were not on the list. In spite of that, it was our intention. It was also the Czech school which we went to in 1943, it was their intention to install a lot of national feelings for Czechoslovakia among all the students.
What was his name again?
Whose name?
The architect?
Fritz Gross. Fritz Gross When we finished here, you can have a look at some of his pictures. He's really a great architect. He became architect in charge of rebuilding Bedford after the war. He did the town plan for the whole rebuilding. He later on became the chief architect for Rolls-Royce, all the facilities for Rolls-Royce, all the fairs that Rolls-Royce participated in at Farnborough and so forth. He designed these stands and so forth. He was a very, 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 very competent and very competent architect. In fact, he developed, now come to remember, the G plan, which was called after Gross, the G plan, which was in the 30s, before he came to England. He was actually brought to England by the British government because of it being a famous architect from Austria. And the G plan was the scheme developed by him in which space is divided by furniture only and two or three steps. There are no walls. And it was adopted in California in the 30s, and it became a very interesting scheme for layout of homes, especially bungalow-type homes which had no two levels. So if you look around here, you'll find that I tried to some extent
emulate,
yes.
Why do you suppose there were no Jewish families, British Jewish families, who took children, or at least very few?
It's a very difficult question to answer, and most probably I've always wondered, especially it already whilst we were in Bedford, a lot of Jewish families who had their English children evacuated to Bedford would spend the weekends either at Bedford hotels or had an apartment in Bedford in which they would invite the children to spend the weekend with them. They were billeted with English people, and during the time that at the weekends when the parents came from work from London, they would bring the children sort of from wherever they were billeted and spend the weekend. Now, among those were a number who would also invite us, the Czech boys, and the Kinder, the German Kinder, because we were mixed now, to have lunch with them on a Saturday. In the whole of Bedford, there was only one Bedfordian Jewish family, which was a Mr. Rose, who had a boutique in the arcade in off High Street, and he was a very unique person for me because he was a World War I fighter pilot who flew in the Flying Corps, in the Royal, whatever they called it, the Royal Flying Corps. And he used to invite me after Shabbat, after the Sabbath service in our youth synagogue, which was also very unique, and most probably the first one in England.
That was attended those services.
And we went to every Saturday, we went to the Saturday morning service, before my bar mitzvah and after my bar mitzvah. And the entire service was normally run by the older children, and I'm saying those that hadn't gone into the army yet, 16, 17, and 18. And following my bar mitzvah, I also led the service, you know, on one Saturday when I was chosen to lead it. So I knew most of the services by heart by that time because of the number of times. I must say that the melodies that were sung in the synagogue were very much like the melodies, because they were German, and apparently the Czech Jewish community and the Austrian Jewish community used the same melodies, as opposed to the Sfaradim and so forth, which may have used, or Americans in England perhaps, different melodies were used, whether it was Ein Kel Aheinu or Adon Olam Hashem Malach Beterem Kal, if you know all these melodies. So I could, whenever we had a meal with one of these Jewish families that came from London over the weekend, I would be the one that would start Rabotai Nevorech after we had our meal and so forth. Okay.
But you were living with a non-Jewish couple, family.
Never spent one night in one Jewish home, except for the brother-in-law of Fritz Gross, who invited us to his place in London, the same one who wanted to adopt us at the end of the war. They're both not alive anymore. Their daughter, who was six, she's 6 years older than myself, she lives in Israel now. She's in a pretty bad state, but she's 86 years old, and she lives here in Israel, and we look after her and so forth as much as we can.
Did the chancellors provide for a Jewish education for you?
At that time, the general attitude was, you have to go to a service. There were no synagogues in Bedford. So at the beginning, we would go with whatever home we were in, with the children or with these people to a service. I lived for some time with a family who called themselves the British Israelites. They considered themselves Mr. and Mrs. Turtle. They considered themselves a lost tribe of Israel. Now, they invited me to their service. Although we already had our youth synagogue at that time, I would go there and listen to the sermons on Sunday, which sometimes
these were church services.
Oh yes. We would go. I can sing every well-known hymn that exists in the Church of England, whether it's "Onward, Christian Soldiers."
Like Nicholas Winton.
Yes. No, well, Nicholas Winton was born into a converted Jewish family. Because. We participated in the life of these village that we live with. The question started, if you remember, you asked, why did not Jewish families take us in, or anybody? There were no Jewish families except the Roses. And the Roses had two children. And I think that, generally speaking, in England, I would say that 's English families did not take children in. And there may be two reasons for it. Number one, there was a great gap between the well-to-do English families in Bedford, the retired officers and so forth, and the lower class. There was practically no middle class, perhaps the teaching staff and so forth. It's a city of retired colonels above and so forth. And a lower class which worked in the factories, in the Britannia Works, which is the largest marine propeller manufacturing plant. It had Cardington, which built the R-101 Zeppelin, It had a military camp nearby. It had many Air Force bases, U.S. Air Force bases in the area, and which a lot of the people worked. In one of the homes that I lived, at Mrs. Graham's place, the daughter worked and sewed anti-aircraft balloons in Cardington. I would say that the Jewish community considered themselves above the lower class. Now, during this entire period, I worked both mainly paper rounds, which I started very early. I think from the age of 11 already I was... You know what a paper round is, yes?
No.
No, you don't know what a paper round is. I get a bicycle from the shop.
Deliver newspaper?
And I go to the railway station. I pick up something like 50 pounds of newspapers, bring them to the stationers, write down on each one the address, different papers, people, different ones. Then I take my bag, my newspaper bag, sit them in certain order and deliver newspapers. That's called a paper round. And they paid between 8 to 10 shillings a week. When our pocket money, 10 shillings being a half a pound sterling, our pocket money was sixpence a week. So it was an enormous contribution to both my brother and I, because my brother didn't work, number one. And the amount of money that the landladies received for billeting one boy was about 10 or 12 shillings a week. So I think it was below the, I don't know what you would call it, that the better of families wouldn't, they would have, I suppose, if they said this was a nationalistic effort, do this for nothing, maybe they would have. But because they paid this amount of money, it was perhaps an insult in some way. They felt maybe it was something like that. As far as the general question was concerned, I think Nicholas Winton's mother and him didn't find many Jewish families to take children in. So we find that there were some who already arrived, some of the children, German children, arrived already converted to England, so it wasn't a problem for them. And on the whole, they were persecuted because of Judaism, so it was a very nice way of joining the Church of England or whatever.
Let me ask you one last question. How do you think the experience of the war affected you then, and does it affect you now? For example, are there moments on a regular basis where you remember something, that something triggers a memory that that makes you remember something in the past?
I think that during the war, A, because of education, because of our experience, and because of being alone, we considered ourselves, and I think that if you put that question to a lot of people, I think the experience that we went through during the war, for being in England on our own, contributed to our development enormously. So when I married Martha when I was 20 years old, I felt, compared to other 20-year-olds that had lived in Czechoslovakia through the war, non-Jewish, that I was at least 10 years older than they were. So that's the contribution there at that time. And I felt it. We all felt it. And we were much more involved than the English children in what was going on the fronts, whether it was in Russia, in North Africa, much, much more. We kept maps and the progress of the armies and so forth. So we were much more involved. They were involved with sports. We were involved with sports and the war. After the war, and to this very day, I think that I can say one thing. I don't believe in praying to God. In other words, I think that having prayed the entire war, every day and every evening, as we were taught at home, before going to bed and getting up in the morning, a few words, right? Shema Israel and so forth. And that the prayer was accompanied by a wish for our parents to come to us as soon as possible. I'm not talking about surviving, because nobody knew about concentration camps. So, first of all, post-war period is a decision that there is no God, that there certainly is no almighty God that can do all these things that we were taught to believe that he could do. And secondly, I don't think there is a day when I don't see a relationship between parent and children that it doesn't remind me of what we didn't have. And finally, you spoke about non-Jewish friends. I'm sorry to this day that I did not investigate and put questions to these friends who lived after the war, who knew my parents better than we did, about them, about their character and so forth, about what their aspirations were and how they saw this. They were with them for nearly 2 years after we left. So I'm sorry to this day that I didn't ask the right questions at that time.
And how did you find out about your parents?
Very easily. We used to go to the railway station as everybody else did. When returnees from concentration camps were coming back, at a number of places there were lists which carried in courts and at the Jewish community which showed people who had returned. There were also lists which gave the names of my parents and said, please, especially in the courts, anybody who saw this person, please put his name and address here and where he saw him last. So based on that information, when a number of people reported they saw our mother there and our father there, our grandmother there, based on that, the courts in Czechoslovakia pronounced, put out a certificate pronouncing that it is assumed that Mr. Paul Meisel died on such and such a date in such and such a place, the same for my mother. Your tape is finished.
Let me just get the last little part.
I think we have to go.
Yes, I think so.
It's 8 o'clock. Just finish it. I think the last sentence
was... Do you remember your reaction when you finally realized that they had been killed?
To tell you the truth, I never believed it. I kept on going to see all these films of returnees, every picture that was posted of concentration camps, which was a daily thing, of bodies lying, of groups of people marching and going into trains. To this very day, my mother was a very strong character, and I could not accept the fact that she didn't survive. She was so strong in the fact that she led this kitchen in the Russian, I don't know whether I mentioned it, in this Russian prisoner of war camp. I couldn't imagine. And only recently I wrote to the people, to the town where this prisoner of war camp was, and asked if this particular family on whose grounds this camp was located. And in fact, I corresponded in Polish through a friend of mine with a historian who speaks of what happened at that time. But nobody is alive anymore, and I left it too late because there were children there who would have been my age and so forth.
What was the camp?
I beg your pardon?
What was the camp?
My father, according to the Red Cross documents, was killed in Majdanek. And another record, which comes from people who saw him last, was in a camp called Rejovce, which is all in the Auschwitz area, in that area. And my mother, supposedly, also in that area, was annihilated together with all the prisoners, Russian prisoners, during the advance in 43, I think, after Stalingrad, when the Russians were advancing. They, because of the terrible treatment they gave to the Russian prisoners of war, they buried them in communal type of what's the name, and even at that time, even in with that in mind, I thought, well, the Gestapo, whoever was responsible for killing these people, had to have the kitchen working till the last moment before they left. How is it that my mother didn't survive? My father, being a soldier and so forth, very proud, I was convinced that my father would have been very arrogant towards the Germans, and most probably got himself into trouble long before. Hello, excuse me, Ken Yecholon.